remember last time, we were doing a calculation of someone's gross pay, and we were basing it on two different things. Number one, their job type determined their wage rate, and number two, their job type determined whether they got overtime or not. Other than that, it's basic rate times hours, again, plus any overtime, with their wage rate being determined by the type of employee they were. And doing this job has given me a greater appreciation of those TV chefs that talk while they're like chopping vegetables at the same time. You know, it's hard sometimes to be typing and saying other words. And sometimes I can do it, but apparently not on a Monday morning. So I just stopped to remember the URL I was typing in. I'm just typing. I hit a wrong key, no big deal. But like when they're chopping carrots, if they chop wrong, their figure's gone, you know. So at any rate, we left off with this. I had written what I described as a stub function, a couple stub functions actually, where in a stub function you can think of that as being an incomplete function. In other words, I'm not doing the whole job yet, but I'm doing pieces of it, and I'm doing it in such a way that I can add on to it, and if all of a sudden it stops working, it's a pretty good sign that the last thing I added was the thing that's causing the problem. So, let's pull up the example. I had hours, calculating gross pay. So if I put in 40 hours, say their manager, calculate gross pay $600. Now that happens to be right, all right, because I had hard-coded it to be $15 an hour. I think these guys make 15, you guys make 12, and these guys make 10, I think is what I said. And there's no overtime paid. All right, if we look at the code, there's no overtime paid right now in the calculation. So if you look at what I did, I have my event starting the ball rolling, calling process form. Process form sort of follows that same pattern that we had last time. We do a validation of the form. Again, validate form with the parentheses after it means it's calling a function. The function just doesn't happen to require any arguments. This implies what the validate form function is returning is a Boolean. All right, a Boolean is something that's either true or false. So I'm asking if the return value from this function equals true or not. And again, because it's already a Boolean, I could also say this, and it would work the same. All right, if it's valid, then I go and try to calculate the results. Now, both validate form and calculate results are what I call stub functions because they don't do everything yet. They're just like part of the function. Validate form just always assumes that it's true, all right? It always assumes the form is valid. So between now and the time until I write this, I'm going to behave and put in proper values so that the form does its calculation. Calculate results right now always assumes different rates and never assumes overtime. And it just does the calculation of gross pay as being hours times rate and displays the results. And like I said last time, when I came back in, I said last time, when I come back in on Monday, I will know that at least that part worked, so I could work on the other stuff. In fact, I even left myself little comments about what I needed to do. I need to implement the different rates, and I need to implement overtime. All right, so let's do those. And since we started on calculate results, let's do that one first. All right? So the first thing we have to do is we have to get the employee type. All right? And again, we don't have to do any validation here, remember, because the validation is going to be taken care of in the other function. So we can assume that they have a valid employee type. So I'm going to create a variable for type and initialize it just to an empty string. How am I going to pull the type? You don't have to tell me the exact statements, but explain to me how I'm going to obtain the type from this radio button.
Get elements by ID.
Get elements by what?
Oh, by name.
By name, right. Why am I using name instead of ID, which I've used so far? Right, because I don't want an element. I want a group of elements. I want all of the radio buttons that belong in the group. I actually could write this saying get element by ID and look at the first one, then look at the second one, then look at the third one. We did that example sometime last week where we did something like that. But it's much better instead to loop through them. All right? The reason it's better to loop through them is because if I were to add another type of employee, a supervisor or whatever, accountant or whatever, then I wouldn't have to change that code to add in another radio button. The loop would automatically take one more iteration. So I'm going to say radio buttons equals document. Again, document means it's on this page. Get elements by name. Just the fact that they change from element to elements is a tip-off that you're going to get more than one. And what's the name I'm looking for? I'm looking for the name of RB type. So now I have a variable called RBS that includes an array of elements, an array of radio buttons in this case. So there's three of them, all right, because I have three of them on the page. And their numbers are 0, 1, and 2. And what's my strategy going to be to find out which one is checked and to get the value?
You're going to do a for loop.
You're going to do a loop.
That counts through.
All right. That's going to count through. It's going to have the values of 0, 1, and 2. So it's going to execute three times. And each time through, it's going to look to see if that radio button is checked. If it's checked, then we have a winner. And we grab its value. You see, if I ask for the value of this radio button, this radio button is always going to have a value of T. Alright? The value of T is only important if that one is the checked radio button. So if I said, you know, document get element by ID, RBTR, value, it's always going to be T. Well, that's not meaningful unless it's checked. So I first have to see if it's checked, then I know the value is meaningful. So I'll put in here for I equals 0. First time through the loop, I want to look at the first one. What's the number of the first one? Number of the first one, 0. I'm going to repeat this as long as I is less than RBS dot something. What is that something? Length. I can never remember if it's length or size. Is that a function? don't remember. So let's Google JavaScript array for loop. And again, I talk about this a lot where, I understand what I need to do. I just, I'm old. I write in a million different languages or have written in a million different languages. Sometimes the syntax gets a little confusing. So I'm not like Googling every step of the way. I know how to do this. It's just a matter of like, is it size or length? Is it an attribute or a... And it is not. It's an attribute. It's not a function. So I can say dot length. Then what does that mean? I++. Add one to I each time. So in other words, what I'm doing is I'm running through the list in order. I'm looking at the 0th element. I'll look at the element 1. I'll look at element 2. And then it will drop out of the loop. Why will it drop out of the loop? Because I will at that point have a value of 3. After we do the loop with I having a value of 2, it comes up, increments the loop, increments the counter again, changes the counter to 3, and 3 is no longer less than the length of the array, because the length of the array is 3. So 3 is not less than 3, so we drop out of the loop. So that's what we do. What am I going to do? I'm going to look to see if RBS sub I, that's how you read that syntax. Again, RBS being a list or an array of elements, you have to refer to the number of the element that you want. So we want the ith element. And again, as we described before, I is going to be 0 the first time, 1 the second time, 2 the third time. If it is checked, then we have a winner. And again, checked is a Boolean. So I could just say if RBS sub 1 is checked, or RBS 1 checked. I don't have to say equals true. I could say equals true, but I could also say this. If it's checked, then the type equals the value that is associated with that radio button. All right. In other words, we have a winner. Let's grab its value. Now, I could go on and write more code if I wanted to. But I'm going to be cautious. And I'm going to pop up an alert box that tells me the type that was selected. So I'm not going to go ahead and I'm going to write the rest of the code yet. I'm going to do this. When I'm done with this loop, type should be the right value. I'm going to check it out. I'm putting in an alert. This is just a debugging tool. All right? I'm just, if I'm not grabbing the value of the employee's type correctly, there's no need for me going on and trying to do the rest of the stuff, right? Because the calculations aren't going to work correctly. And if I wrote a bunch more code here and I had an error somewhere in here, then I would be debugging a whole list of code when really the problem was in these lines. So I'm going to go and do this, and I'm going to check to see. If I pick manager, it tells me that the code is M. Looks like we're doing good. Associate, A, trainee, T. All right, we're doing that right. How long did that take to do? That took, even with me yakking through it, it probably didn't take me a minute to do that. So I didn't waste a lot of time doing this. However, if there indeed was a problem with this, I don't know, if I was really having a bad day and I said that equals false, for example, instead equals true, all right, then it would have saved me a lot of trouble because I would have checked am, and it would tell me that they're a trainee. All right? Well, obviously I did something wrong. And it would then be easy to find because I'd only be looking at these lines of code, the new lines of code that I've entered in here. All right? So take a minute to check your work before you go on to the next little piece. Do it in little pieces. Now, as you get more and more proficient, those little pieces might become a little bigger, all right? But, and again, I'm not describing myself as like a perfect programmer, all right? But I've literally been writing programs for 40 years, all right? Which really, I shouldn't have done that calculation in my head because now I feel really depressed, all right? But I've literally been writing code for 40 years. And when I write code, I take this approach. I don't try to write the whole section of code. I do a little piece, get that working, take a minute to verify that it's working, then go on to the next piece. So now I can get rid of that. It did its job. And I can have a series of if statements to actually determine the rate. So if type equals manager, then rate equals 15. If type equals associate, rate equals 12. If type equals trainee, then rate equals 10. And I'm going to change this initialization to 0. All right? So bam, I added another 6 lines of code here. All right? And I can test to make sure that they work before I go on to the overtime calculation. Alright, so if they worked 40 hours and their manager should still say $600. If their associate, it should say $480. If they're a trainee, it should say $400. Boom, it works. Alright, so I did a little bit, tested a little bit. Alright, testing is something that I don't think even a lot of experienced developers do a good job at. I know it really took me a long time to learn how to test my code well. All right. What are the tip-offs? How do you get to do that? What lessons have I learned in 40 years of testing? Well, number one is test little pieces at a time. Don't do your whole program and then try to test everything. All right. And that goes for all sorts of testing. In the world of web, that relates to browser compatibility testing, too. Now, browser compatibility testing is less of an issue than it was in the past in one respect, but in another respect with mobile devices, you know, it's still an issue that needs to be considered. So test your code across platforms. Make sure that there isn't something you're doing that doesn't work in one of the platforms that you need to support. All right. Again, in the old days, when there was a big difference between how Netflix and Internet Explorer, how Netscape and Internet Explorer dealt with things, people would write their code, get it working perfectly in browser A, run it on browser B, and find that it was a mess. And then they'd get all mad and they'd yell at the browser and all that. It's like, well, ain't the browser's fault, man. It's your fault for not doing incremental testing. Now, I could leave this code here. What else could I do with this code? Well, boy, that's an open-ended question, right? I could make a function for it. Why would I want to make a function for it?
If you add more associates, it would be a lot easier.
If you add more job types, it would be easier to change. All right? So that's what I'm going to do, because I want to promote good programming practices. Remember, a program, two programs that work, that produce the same results, If one is more maintainable than the other, the more maintainable one is better then. So it's not just a matter of like, well, as long as you get the right answer, it doesn't matter how you did it. How you did it does matter with respect to how easy it is to change. The cost of changing software is can be very high. If you use good programming practices, you can sort of lower that. So I'm going to write another function that says, I have a function called getRate. And it's going to accept as an argument the job type. And it's going to return the rate. Changing these variables for a reason. We'll talk about that reason in a minute here. By convention, I put arg in front of my arguments, just so I know that it's being passed into the function. What's an argument? Again, an argument is a parameter that's passed to the function for the function to do its thing. In other words, this is going to get the rate depending on the type of employee. Well, we need to give this function the kind of employee, and we're doing that via a variable called arg type. All right? And result is where we're putting the result in there, and we're returning it. So this function has an input and has an output. We give it the employee type, we return the wage rate. Now this is a good function because it doesn't depend on the page that it's on. It doesn't refer to radio buttons or drop downs or whatever. So I could actually include this function on other pages. All right. Maybe there might be another page that does a similar calculation, or maybe that calculates net pay or something. I don't know. All right. I could include this function in there because everything it needs, it gets passed in, and then it returns the value. So I could actually put this in an external JavaScript file. I'm not going to do that right now, but I could. Anything that could be shared or reused among pages, I'm going to put in an external JavaScript file. And now I just say rate equals get rate, and I'm going to give the argument of type. Could this function refer to the variable type that was defined in this function? Can this function get rate refer to this variable type that was defined in this function? The answer is no, it cannot. All right? If a variable is defined in a function, it can only be used inside that function. If another function needs it, then you pass it as an argument. Could you make it a global variable? Could I define it outside of any functions? Yes, you can, but generally that's a bad idea. You don't want what are so-called global variables, that is, variables that can be touched by any function, because you may have a function change it that shouldn't be changing it, that you're not realizing is changing it. And therefore, it's better to pass via an argument. Same thing like, could this function refer to result? No, it couldn't, because result was defined inside this function, therefore it's not available inside this function. So we're going to return the result. And whatever the result gets returned gets put in here. All right, so now I've changed this, all right, and I should test it because I've changed it. Now, I think I did it right, right? But, you know, everyone that's ever wrote a program thinks they've done it right, and yet there's programs that have bugs in them. So, therefore, I moved some code around since the last time I tested it, so I'm going to want to go and change it. So, refresh, 40, oops. All right, it looks like it still works. All right. So now, I'm going to calculate let me ask you, can we move this into its own function? Well, the answer is yeah, of course we could. All right. What would be the advantage of doing that? Well, the advantage of doing that is this function, the calculate results, is going to become real, real, real clean. All right? So, what I'm going to do is cut this, create a function called getType. Return the result. Is this result the same as this result? No. They're both defined within their respective functions, so they're both local variables. They're both only available in that function. And now I'm going to say type equals getType. I think you can see where this is heading. I could put a create a calculate pay function. All right. What will that calculate pay function do? It can calculate the gross pay. And then see if they deserve overtime and calculate the net pay as well, or the overtime pay as well. So, when do you stop breaking things down into functions? I don't know. All right. Are there any other questions? No, you do it in a way that seems right, is the best thing I can say. If it's something that is standalone, definitely if it's something you can reuse, you might want to break it out into its own function. That way you can reuse that logic on another page, for example. In this case, my goal is to make this a very clear-cut function of what it's doing. In other words, if I don't need to touch that getType function, if I'm pulling the type correctly, all right, then I don't even need to look at this code. If the problem is with the rates, let's say I change the rates, to get rate and change that. So you write it in a way that's clear, logical, and readable. All right? A guideline that people have said, and this might be a little different in my case because I have the font bigger to show you on the screen. But a criteria I've heard is you try to make a function so that at a normal font is contained within one screen. The thought being that if it's contained in one screen, you can look at it and get your head around it, all right, without having to scroll up and down and sideways and so on and so forth. So one screen's worth of data, of lines of instructions in a function, is sort of a good guideline, all right? If it's bigger than that, then think about breaking it into functions, all right? There almost aren't, you know, you almost can't overkill with breaking it into functions, all right? But it's personal preference. I mean, it's not like there's a charge per function, you know, that, you know, you'll get charged an extra 10 cents if you add another function or something like that, all right? So really, really doesn't matter. So just to talk about that balance a little bit, I'm going to include the overtime function. I'm going to keep the pay function and the overtime function as part of this function. Again, we could break it out if we wanted to. So, if type equals A or type equals T, then they get paid overtime. All right? Let's make sure that we understand this. Remember, what's within the parentheses? What's within the parentheses is a condition that gets evaluated to either true or false. A Boolean expression. All right? A Boolean expression. So, when there is an or here, the big condition will be true if this one is true, or that one is true, or they're both true. All right? So an or means one, the other, or both. It's not an exclusive or. An exclusive or is where only one of them can be true. So if the type is associate, or the type is trainee, then the overtime calculation applies. Now in this case, you know that both can't be true, right? Because they're mutually exclusive. But in a more general case, mutually exclusive. Now, I could also put the and here because there's another condition. And that is that the hours has to be greater than 40. But that would get to be sort of a complex instruction. And therefore, I'm going to break down that one big complex condition into two smaller conditions. In other words, I could write this. If hours are greater than 40 and type equals T or type equals A, then they get overtime. What I'm going to do is I'm going to test to see, first of all, are they the right type for it? Then if they're the right type, I'm going to ask if hours are greater than 40. So if hours are greater than 40, then they get paid an extra 0.5 times their rate times however many hours are greater than 40. So hours minus 40. You get time and a half for overtime hours. So if you made $10 an hour, you'd get paid 15 for the overtime hours. Remember, the gross pay only takes into account the time. So if I worked 50 hours, for example, this takes care of all 50 of the hours at the straight time. We only need the extra half time for any of those hours over 40. And I can say overtime or gross pay equals whatever gross pay was before plus overtime.
You'd want to make the 0.5, 1.5.
No, that's what I was just saying.
Oh, you don't want to do that?
No. And here's why. Say they work 50 hours. Calculating their gross pay as hours, which is 50, right, times $10 an hour. It gives them $500.
Oh, okay.
This is only calculating the extra overtime pay. Because even a manager gets paid straight time for that. So we're including the overtime hours at straight time get calculated here. This is the overtime incremental that they're getting charged. Right. All right. Let's make sure this works. So if they work 50 hours in their manager, what should they get paid? They should get paid 50 times 16, which is $800? $750. Oh, it's $15, not 16. Okay, that's right. I was thinking $16 an hour. Okay, $750. Well, let's make sure that's right. Yeah, the rates are $15, right? So a trainee should get paid what? Well, they should get paid, I actually did this wrong. It should be 12 and 10. So, an associate should get paid $12 for those 50, which means that their regular pay would be $600. Plus, for those 10 extra dollars, for 10 extra hours, they would get paid an additional $6 an hour. So that would be 600 plus 60 would be 660. All right. Finally, a trainee should get paid, this should be easy, 50 hours at $10 an hour, that's 500, plus an additional 5 for the additional 10 hours, that would be 550. And this works. Or does it? Are we done testing this? How do you know when you're done testing? Because the calculation I'm now done with. Again, I could refactor. What's refactor? That's a fancy name about like changing the code once it works and break things down in other functions. I could put this stuff in other functions if I wanted to. But let's say I don't. It's fine here. So I'm done with the calculation. How do I know that I'm done testing it?
I mean, you can put negative 100 in there and it'll work, but that's probably later.
Okay. Yeah, that would be validation. You're right. If I put in a negative number, it's going to say, hey, wait a minute, you owe me $550 or $500. All right. So yeah, that would be a validation thing because it should be a number 0 or greater. Everyone, close your eyes for a second. I'm serious. Close your eyes. Okay, you can open them now. All right. Let's do the test again. 50 in their manager. 750. Ooh, that worked. 50 in their associate. 660. That worked. 50 in their trainee. 550. That worked. All right, got the same results as we got before. Are we done testing? Well, what about they don't get paid overtime? Did we somehow screw that up by putting in the overtime calculation? Now, you know that I didn't do that screwed up the first time. That's why I had you close your eyes. I went back and intentionally screwed up the non-overtime calculation. So if they get 30 hours, if they work 30 hours, this should be 450 for a manager, which it is. But notice what you get for an associate, or let's do a trainee because that's easier. That should be $300, right? Give me 250. Associate gives me 300, should be giving me 360. What did I do? Well, I commented out the line that looked to see if the hours were over 40. Right? And therefore is expecting them to work overtime, otherwise it's taking it out of their pay for the overtime that they didn't work, the hours less than, and which isn't good. The point is your if statements give you a hint of what you need to test. All right, if you look at your code, your if statements give you a hint of what you need to test. All right. Here we got some if statements. These three things give us different results. So I better test at least these three cases. I better test a manager, an associate, and a trainee, right? Because I can see in my program that I'm going to get different results if it's a manager, if it's an associate, or it's a trainee. I also am going to get different results if the hours are greater than 40 or not greater than 40. So I would say minimally there should be 6 test cases here. How did I get 6? Overtime and non-overtime for manager, overtime, non-overtime for associate, overtime, non-overtime for trainee. So the 3 job types, both overtime and non-overtime, that's 6 test cases. Now you could test more. Right? It'd be interesting if it does exactly 40 correctly. Because sometimes it's a matter of should that be a lot greater than or greater than or equal to. Sometimes it would matter, sometimes it would. In this particular case, it really doesn't matter. All right? But you might want to test right at the border between the conditions, like test 39, 40, and 41. So maybe I have those 3 conditions for all 3, and I get 9 test cases. The bottom line is, I didn't test this until I looked at the clock and said, well, the day's done, all right, time to go. I tested this by systematically knowing how the program worked and understanding the different conditions and the different things that would possibly make this program differently. So in this case, to test this program, I would say you need 6 or 9 test cases. This is a simple program, all right? This is a simple script, just something I demonstrated using to demonstrate some concepts and some techniques, all right? When you start thinking about complex programs, like an actual payroll, what are some of the facts, especially like when you start putting taxes in there, you know, your tax depends on how many dependents you have, what your filing says is married or head of household or single, how many deductions that you have, and so on and so on and so forth. It gets to be very, very complicated. And from that perspective, it's no wonder that there are bugs to programs, all right? So ideally, you want as much coverage as possible when you test this, all right? So think about testing and think about the conditions that you want to test, and don't just run it through a few times and put some numbers in and, well, those 3 times I put it in worked. Systematically think of what causes a program to give different results and test those conditions. All right, next time we'll pick up on the validation and go from there. All right. We'll see you over in lab.